Please welcome to Game City Nights for the first time the legend that is the father, that is Mr. Ian Livingstone.
Thank you.
Ian, welcome. Good of you to join us. Please come and have a seat. Ian got off the train this morning at about it was the early train that ended up being late, pausing to deliver you, wasn't it? It was about 10:30, I think, when you arrived in the end. It's been a non-stop day of activities for you. Are you bearing up?
I'm just a young kid having fun, mate. Yeah, I'm good.
Well, so tonight what we wanted to do was... There's a huge amount written about Tomb Raider, about Games Workshop, about Fighting Fantasy. But I think the thing that I'm particularly interested in is actually you, in a nice way.
This is not going well, is it?
No, it's going well. Nobody feels uncomfortable.
I feel like I've been lured into a trap here.
No, not at all. So your career can be characterised by, you know, you've been involved in three, four internationally. Known franchises. So this can't be an accident, right? This has happened to this one person. So I'm kind of really interested to find out tonight. I'm really interested in learning what it kind of feels like to be Ian Livingstone and what it meant to be involved in those things. So we talk a lot about creative industries, but we tend to do that, you know, from a slightly distance perspective. And you've been right next to the flame, you know, with a number of really important. Really important IP. So, with your permission, I'd quite like to focus on that bit of your career, if that's all right. Is that all right with you?
So yeah, anything's fine. I'm good.
Yeah, completely. You don't mind answering anything at all.
I'm too old to care if you embarrass me. It's fine.
That is good news. Can we go back to where it began for you then in the late 60s, which was, I believe, in Manchester, and you went to
that's my school,
Altrincham Grammar School.
That's me.
Uh-huh. Yeah. So that was where you went. Am I right in thinking you was Steve?
That's where I met Steve Jackson at school. Yeah.
Right. Your experience of being at school, you've kind of alluded this to in a few interviews that we talked about in the past, was you didn't particularly enjoy it. Is that right? The kind of work that you produced wasn't.
Well, it was a very old-fashioned school. I mean, it actually was a good school, and it is a very good school today. But the teachers we had way back then didn't really like you unless you were. Super conformist, part of a sausage machine. They talked at you. You took down notes. You regurgitated them to order, and then you passed exams. Mm-hmm. And you came out. I didn't get on very well with most of the teachers, apart from one, Roy Coleman. What else are you going to find out there?
No. That's fine. That was my desktop from when I was researching stuff. Looking for this.
And the headmaster was a particularly bizarre character. He was so disappointed that I scraped in with enough O-levels to go to do A-levels. I just managed to get 5 O-levels, and he said to me, Livingstone, I know you're passing everything, but don't you think you'd be better off going and work in a garage or something? And it was just not a very enjoyable experience, other than this one salvation was Roy Coleman, and he recognized people's individuals, that we weren't all the same, and we had... You know, we did have ideas, and having ideas and not being conformist was actually a good thing because it questioned established views, and it was a bit of original thought. All those who just wanted to do what they were told and go and have some boring accounting job, they were the ones that were congratulated by the order then. And I guess we kind of kicked against it. I remember leading a... it was good fun. There was a enforced cross-country...
Right, yeah.
At school, and I managed to get everybody to protest by walking for the first half mile and just watching all the teachers steaming. So I didn't do particularly well at school. Got 5 O-levels, 1 A-level, and right. didn't go to university.
What did your parents want you to do?
Well, my father had worked for the same company for 40 years. He was a very proud, very unassuming man, fantastic guy. And all he wanted was for me to succeed and to look after my mother. So he was so desperate that I did the traditional career thing. And yet when we started Games Workshop, I only worked in the real world, for other people for like 2 years of my life. And when I announced that I wasn't going to do that anymore, he said, okay, great. I mean, you could see the disappointment on his face, but he didn't try to stop it. I mean, I was living in London at the time, but having him work for the same company for 40 years. But I always wanted to determine my own destiny, create content, explore stuff.
And did you know, you knew that when you were at school? I mean, so was there any particular...
Well, I don't think I knew that.
You started writing stories, you started... Did that begin when you were at school?
No, not really. I mean, I had a good imagination. I used to read loads of comics.
Right.
I used to read lots of science fiction. I loved stuff of the imagination. I liked being in worlds where you couldn't be in real life. I loved escapism. And I loved games. Mm-hmm. You know, at school, I used to win most of the games of Monopoly, and I was in the chess team.
Right.
And I used to like reading books. So it's that combination of games and books, enjoyment, I think, might have had some contribution towards fighting fantasy.
So you and Steve moved to London together, is that right?
No.
What happened?
He went off to Keele University,
right?
And there was a third member of Games Workshop at the beginning, another guy from Culture and Grammar called John Peake, and he went to, I can't remember which university he went to, and I didn't go to university, and but we all met back in London.
Right.
We'd all managed to get jobs in London, okay. So we decided to live together.
What, you was at Conoco Oil you were working, is that right?
I was at Conoco Oil.
Well, what were you doing there? What sort of jobs were you being given?
I was doing... I ended up doing an HND in business studies, and I learned a bit about marketing and a bit about economics. And so I was doing exactly that.
So
most of the time, staring out the window, thinking, I don't want to be here.
Yeah. And Steve and the other partner were thinking
the same. So really, we had pretty awful jobs, and we didn't have much money. So we used to, in our flat, we'd just play board games, the usual stuff. Avalon Hill games, SPI games, diplomacy, and that's how that idea of, well, can't we turn our hobby into a business at some point?
So this is in Bolingbroke
Road.
Right. This is just to give a sense of what this looks like today. So it was 25, was it? Hopefully we've got the right road here.
Is
that just here? Because you're on the top floor, is that right?
Top floor. Is that?
So I think it's this door here. That's 26.
I thought it was 24, but Matt, you could be 25. You might know more than me.
It was 25 last night when you...
One of those windows is the window of Games Workshop.
Right.
And
it began as mail order.
You see people on the street. There we go. One Games Workshop, up here, mate. Yeah.
So it began as mail order from that bedsit, is that right?
What happened was the three of us decided we were going to make this games company, and John was a very good craftsman. He was actually an engineer by trade. And so he started making, we had a spare bedroom, traditional wooden games like backgammon boards, Wari boards, Go boards, and things. I'd go out and sell them, and then Steve would do all the invoicing.
Right.
Not that this was an amazing business, we were hardly selling anything.
So when you say you used to go out and sell them, where were you doing that?
There was a one game shop in the UK then, I think it was called Just Games. Uh-huh. Or was it Night Games? There's two game shops.
Right.
And also got an order from Harrods as well.
Right.
So they were
good games.
We were going to Habitat, buying faulty breadboards, drilling them and turning them into solitaire games of solitaire with marbles.
And you're doing this, you still all had day jobs at this point?
Yeah,
or was it starting to become...
Yeah.
But it was starting to gather pace.
Yeah,
and
well,
we building around it.
It was February 75 when we decided we needed to communicate to the world that Games Workshop was here, because it wasn't a real business then. So we created this magazine, which we called Owl and Weasel. This full-colour glossy magazine you see before you. it was priced at 10 pence, and it was just made out of just an old typewriter and some various bits of old letter set which we had with mixed typefaces, because we didn't have enough letters of each each one. That's why the 15 is like much larger type size than the Bolingbroke. It's 15 Bolingbroke Road, look.
Well, I thought it was 15, but I said that to you over email, and you emailed last night and said it was 25. I can't remember.
I was 15. Yeah, you should have done your research.
I assumed it was a typo.
No, 15. Now I remember. Anyway, we sent that Alan Weasel, with my marketing background, to everybody we knew in games.
Mm-hmm.
And one of the copies found its way to the young Gary Gygax. not so young there. R.I.P. He was a fantastic character.
So people who aren't familiar with who Gary Gygax is, do you want us to explain how important he is in the...
Gary Gygax and Dave Arnson created Dungeons & Dragons, and they were based in Lake Geneva, Wisconsin. And Dungeons & Dragons was the... let's find out. Who's played Dungeons & Dragons? Okay, so we don't need to tell you anything about it. Anyone know about it but not played it? Who's never heard of the bloody thing at all? Okay, we don't need to explain much about it. So Arnson and Gygax created Dungeons & Dragons. People say who did what. I think it's difficult to know, really, but I think Arnson must have created a lot of the original set of rules, although Gygax had actually created the original fantasy supplement to Chainmail, which is a predecessor to D&D. Anyway, it doesn't matter. They created this thing together, but Gary was the driving force. He was the power to promoting D&D. And we ended up being sent a copy of one of these in this brown box. Now going on eBay for about $2,000, if anyone's got one in the room. A good quality brown box. There's only 1,000 made, or less. We were sent a copy of D&D. Steve and I and John played it. John thought it was the most disgusting thing ever created. He was a traditional board gamer. At that point, he said, I'm not interested in this. I want to carry on making traditional games. Steve and I played it, thought it was the best game ever created, known to mankind.
So he didn't like it on the grounds that it was...
role-playing, like fairies and goblins and stuff.
Right.
So he couldn't stand the idea of role-playing. It was just like, ooh. Get a life sort of stuff. And so at that point, Steve and I said, well, we want to do this and nothing else.
Yeah.
And he said, well, I'm out. So he left at that point with his bandsaw and was gone. Sad, but you know, he had no interest in role-playing games. So we ordered 6 copies of D&D, and on the back of that, we got a exclusive distribution agreement for 3 years for the whole of Europe. Such was our significant order.
Yeah.
Because what we didn't realize at the time is that Gary Gygax was also working out an apartment, and it was a very hand-to-mouth business for him. So we were both role-playing businessmen about a role-playing game.
Mm. And that was tremendously successful, the Dungeons & Dragons.
We did sell our first 6 copies quite easily, yeah.
Yeah, so and you reordered.
And then we ordered more, and we started selling it through Alan Weasel. And people were expecting to, because we called the company Games Workshop, they thought it was a shop. Uh-huh. So we used to see these people from that window, which was the wrong one, because you didn't go to 15. It was on the other side of the street.
We could reshoot it afterwards, and I get the right window, if you want.
Yeah. And people would be milling around on the street, looking at Alan Weasel, where's this shop? He said, want Games Workshop? Up here, mate. So they'd be coming in up and down. At the same time, irritating the landlord on the ground floor, for the number of people coming in and out and the increasing number of parcels being delivered. And of course, in those days, not only were there no mobile phones, we didn't even have a phone in our flat. Mm. And the only phone was a public payphone on the ground floor. And every time it rang, it was invariably a mail order for workshop. And on a Friday, Paddy was invariably worse for wear. And phone would ring, Steve and I would like rush down the street trying to answer the phone. Sadly, too late. Hello, do you want Games Workshop, do you? Well, you can piss off! And we understood the value of public relations early on.
Yeah.
And, but made people even more determined to find where we were.
Yeah, amazing. So what was the way that you were communicating at that point was Alan Weasel, White Dwarf, when did that...
White Dwarf came about after 25 issues of Weasel in, I think it was June 77. Right.
So to give people, because a lot of people here won't know about things like, you know, print flyers and not having Twitter and not being able to immediately communicate everything about something within seconds to everyone in the world.
Yeah.
So can you give some sort of sense of what the kind of print run of that, what the kind of reach was of that, and I guess how long it takes to gestate something. It's a bit difficult to relate to.
At its high point, Alan Weasel had 200 subscribers.
200?
200.
Right.
And the initial print run we did for White Dwarf 1 was 4,000.
Right.
So that was a big risk for us. by 77, there was a few independent shops stocking role-playing products from us, D&D and other stuff that we were importing, because we'd also gone to Gen Con in 1976 to meet Gygax and sign up all the fledgling games companies like Judges Guild and Fantasy Games Unlimited and Chaosium. We just signed a lot. And so we had this, you know, this. And then that was also a funny time because we'd been thrown out of our flat prior to going to Gen Con 76. So we stuck all the stock we had into my girlfriend's flat at that time, went over, had nowhere to live when we came back, goes to the bank manager, rather like people today trying to go to the bank manager to raise finance for digital content. It was the same old problem then. They just didn't understand games, and you know, you go in and ask money for a bank manager, tell him about D&D, and he looks at you rather like an Alsatian watching television, thinks you're completely mad, and just kind of ushers you out the door. So we ended up having to live in a van for just over 3 months, because we found a small office at the back of a estate agent's. And that was our kind of little triangular life. Fortunately, the estate agent was next to a squash court, which we joined.
Right.
So we out the van, 7:30, into the squash court for a shave, shower, etc. Got very good at squash by default. And then into the office at about 8 o'clock, stayed there 12 hours, sometimes more, then back into Steve's stinky van.
Right.
For listening to the rain tipple down. Yeah. And but that was okay. Yeah.
How old are you at this point? Mid-20s, is this?
20 in the van, 26.
Yeah. 26, right.
But when you start your own business, you just don't care. It's not seen as hardship. This is part of the fun. This is why we're doing it. You know, you're controlling your own destiny. And even if you fail, I think it's better to try and fail than not to try at all. I'm absolutely unemployable now. And I think I was pretty unemployable back then because I had no desire to work for other people.
Did you have a sense of what you were trying to build? I mean, did you have...
No.
You didn't have any
attempts to build. We were following a dream, turning our hobby into a business.
Right.
And we were creating the market because there was no games market. So we were probably making loads of mistakes, but at the same time, learning from those mistakes. Mm. But everything was being funded out of cash flow because there was no way you could borrow money for a games company back then. Especially not this weirdo, dragon, weirdy thing that we were doing.
Because another one of your problems was that you couldn't really take them to retail. So as well as the banks, I remember you recalling it was very difficult to get the product into shops because equally they didn't get it. Where do you put it?
Well, some got it, but not enough. And that precipitated us opening our own shop in 77.
Right.
That combined with the fact that the little mail order, the small office we were operating out of had become too small, so it was at the back of a state agent, so we asked them to find us a shop, and this is it. So this is opening day in April 1978, the first Games Workshop, and anybody in that crowd I'm still yet to meet.
So tell me about one of the things that survived to this day about Games Workshop, that also comes out from the sense of community that you're talking about from Alan Weasel and from White Dwarf. There's a real kind of open, inclusive, kind of educational feel about the stores. So presumably that emerged by design from your enthusiasm. Was that the kinds of things that you used to use during game nights or game days, which fed into the stores, is that right?
Yeah, games days, painting days. Well, we felt very much a sense of community because we were gamers ourselves. If we were selling... you know, frying pans, we wouldn't be doing any of this stuff. We'd be hiring traditional retailers to work in our shops. But because the games required a certain amount of knowledge to explain, we hired gamers. And even though they weren't the best retailers, they looked kind of crazy and weird and gothic, it didn't matter because their enthusiasm was so, and their knowledge was so great that people loved just coming into workshop, learning, and therefore saying, oh, I want to buy some of this stuff. So they were effectively brilliant retailers just because of their knowledge and experience and their, you know, helping build this community. Yeah. And we felt comfortable in that environment because we were gamers too. If we were trying to tell non-gamers to sell our stuff, I think that would have been awkward.
Yeah.
So it's much better for us to create our own community.
Yeah. So you talked later on about what you were kind of inadvertently doing was creating what, you know, a business person would describe as vertical integration. So you were manufacturing, you were controlling the distribution, and you were controlling the retail, but you didn't plan that at the time. This was by necessity, is that right?
Look, we took the glory for that, but it was absolute tosh. We did it through necessity.
Yeah.
They used to say, oh, a fantastic business plan. Yes, you're getting your cash in early before you have to pay your suppliers and you're promoting your own product through your own magazine. This is brilliant, brilliant business. We did it because we were rejected from all quarters. We created our own magazine, White Dwarf, because nobody else wanted to write about role-playing games. We opened our own shops because nobody else wanted to stop role-playing games. Mm. And we created our own miniatures because the US ones were just too expensive to import. So everything was done to serve our own purpose, really.
So the store was obviously very successful. At what point did you, or was there a point where you stopped to be funded out of kind of cash flow and natural growth? Was there a point where investors came in around?
We managed to get a bank loan. You know, the banks, as usual, they don't understand content and they'll only lend you money when you can categorically prove you don't need it. Yeah. So We did get a small bank loan and then helped us to fund the expansion when we started to open more stores and then start publishing under license.
Right.
We published D&D under license. But remember, that was only a 3-year agreement. And in 1978, we had to make a big decision because Gary Gygax said, look, 3 years is up. We want to merge the two companies, TSR and Games Workshop, as one unit.
Right.
And Steve and I were violently independent, as I think a lot of people in the UK are. And we realized that if we were to survive as independents, we need to create some new IP. Uh-huh. And that was really gave rise to getting the guys at Citadel mainly to create Warhammer. So that was led by Brian Ansell,
right.
Halliwell, and who else was it on it? Rick Priestley,
right.
To set about creating Warhammer. To replace D&D. We were still distributing D&D, but we'd lost exclusivity, and TSR ended up setting up their own UK operation.
Mm. So over that kind of following 5 years from that first store, how many stores did you grow to? How fast did the retail operation grow?
We opened half a dozen stores quite quickly. Manchester, right. Nottingham, Sheffield,
right.
Birmingham.
Some other places. Yeah, but the headquarters.
Edinburgh, I think.
The manufacturing headquarters was based here. For Citadel.
We had the distribution for the game still in London at that point. Uh-huh. And we opened quite a large warehouse in London in Park Royal, Sunbeam Road.
Right.
And when Brian Ansell joined the company, he was based in Nottingham, in Newark. Mm-hmm. And he had previously had his own miniatures company, Asgard Miniatures. And he said, look, I'll run your Citadel miniatures for you. We'll build a factory.
Right.
And it just made sense to locate that where he was rather than us trying to get him to come down to London, which wasn't geographically great for distribution. Mm. And neither was it cheap because of the cost of labor. So we agreed that Citadel would be set up here in Newark. So and then we eventually moved the games distribution also to the Midlands because that made sense for the very same reasons.
So as the business grew, it sounds like you've now starting to get hundreds of staff under your, you know, onto your payroll, and it sounds like the culture within which you like to operate, it seems that you like to operate, must necessarily have changed. So what was your day-to-day role must have been more executive, I'm assuming, was it?
I suppose it was. I've always enjoyed being on the content side, and I quite like the marketing side. The way people use social media today and all the wonderful avenues for non-traditional marketing that you can get today is, I wish we'd had it back then.
Yeah.
So, but we had to do stuff. So I was concerned really with, with the stores and the marketing and finding new products and trying to get more games to publish under license and suggesting, what we should do to expand the business. And Yeah.
Okay. So Games Workshop grew and continued to grow. Yeah. Central Dominions just grew and continued to grow. And then the whole project came to the attention of Penguin. Is that right? And they talked about commissioning a book about role-playing games first.
That's right. It was, we used to run Games Days, and Games Day 1980. We had companies other than Games Workshop there. So right. One of those companies was Penguin Books.
Right.
They had published a book called Playing Politics. And I don't know the reason why they won a stand at Games Day, but they did. But the editor, Geraldine Cook, was amazed at the 5,000 people in the hall going mad about playing D&D and other role-playing games. And so she said to Steve, would we be interested in writing a book about role-playing? And we thought about that and thought, well, wouldn't it be better if we wrote a book that is role-playing rather than writing about it? So we said we could demonstrate role-playing if we wrote a small adventure.
Uh-huh.
And as we thought about that over time, we expanded that adventure until it became a full-blown book. And that was the birth of Warlock of Firetop Mountain. But in the meantime, we'd also written to George, Allen and Unwin, or Steve had, to suggest that we write an interactive adventure based on Lord of the Rings.
Right.
Luckily, we got a very short rejection letter, because otherwise we'd have created content for somebody else. We would never have owned the intellectual property as we do in Fighting Fantasy. So that was a godsend, that rejection letter.
Yeah.
And in the end, after a year of deliberation, Geraldine Cook said, yep, we're going to do it. And then they had to argue with whether it should be a puffin book or a penguin book, and they decided that it would be more suited to children. And then we wrote Warlock. It came out in August 1982, 30 years this year. And
he was there.
And throw me now. And they didn't do any marketing whatsoever.
So this year of deliberation, is that because they didn't get it? Is this the dog being shown a cartridge?
Their general sales staff and marketing people just didn't get it.
Right.
It looked like a normal book, but their similarity ended. They'd never seen an interactive book before.
Right.
And so it when Warlock launched, it didn't do well for the first couple of weeks. But then Steve and I mentioned it in our own press dealings.
Right.
And talked about it in White Dwarf. And gradually, just one or two schools picked up on them, and local bookshops were reporting sales of this funny, weird book being sold. And then that sort of power word of mouth, you can't get better than that even today.
Yeah.
It spread from playground to playground, and suddenly the whole of the country got networked with virality. And Warlock went out of print, and Penguin still couldn't get their head around it. So they reprinted, and they reprinted, and they reprinted, and I think they did 10 reprints of quite small numbers, 5,000, until the editor finally came and said, I think we need two more of these. And so it'd been an absolute nightmare writing the first one together.
Yeah,
I wrote all the first bit up to the river, then Steve wrote the second bit, but trying to mesh all these separate storylines together necessitated one style. So Steve had the dubious honor of having to rewrite the whole thing into one consistent story. And but then it was a huge success. So that's why we decided to write the next one separately. So Steve did Citadel of Chaos, and I did Forest of Doom. And number six, got my numbers wrong tonight. Number six, what was number four? Starship Traveler 5. Warlock, Citadel, Forest of Doom, Starship Traveler, City of Thieves,
Isle of the Lizard King was number 7.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And by this time, they'd become a bit of a phenomenon.
Yeah. So you were outselling Roald Dahl, weren't you, at one point?
Apparently so, yes. We were like number 1, 2, and 3 in the bestsellers list. And normally a kid's book would sell 5,000 copies. And I remember when Death Trap came out, it sold 400,000 copies in the UK alone, which was pretty good. And then there was all the foreign sales. The net result was they sold 16 million copies in 28 languages in the end. So,
yeah.
Yeah, it was great.
That's pretty amazing. So you had the time, so GW was big enough for you to have the time to create an entirely new IP that you owned?
Well, we've been running Workshop from 75 till 82. Yeah. We carried on trying to run it from 82 to 85, and those were pretty hectic days because Workshop was expanding like crazy, and going to, we actually had homes by this time, so going to our respective homes and, you know, after a hard day's work, then sitting down from like 8 o'clock till 2 o'clock in the morning writing these books, you know, it was pretty draining even for the, we were nippers still, relatively speaking. But again, it didn't seem that hard, but it was definitely having an effect. So we decided that we needed to have somebody run Workshop. So then we, in 85, so at that point when we appointed Brian Ansell as MD.
So the fighting fantasy things were an absolute phenomenon, and I'm sure a lot of people in the room kind of remember those. I remember those. And they came to the attention then of Mark and Dominic, who were very excited about what you were doing. Is that that's the more or less...
Yeah, I know what you're leading up to. Yes, Dome Mark. Yeah. Dominic and Mark. Mark Straw and Dominic Wheatley. Yeah, these were two young buck advertising execs who decided that they wanted to make a career in video games. And I'm glad they did, because this is really how I got into video games. Although, having said that, we'd also licensed some of our Final Fantasy books as Commodore 64 adventures.
Mm. Did you play video games at that time?
I had a Commodore PET.
Right. So
8K PET.
Right.
It was about this big.
Yeah, no, I remember them, yeah.
With zero memory, but it seemed great at the time. And then the next computer I bought was an Amiga.
So you were aware of video games becoming a...
Yeah, well, we'd licensed some of our Final Fantasy game books.
You didn't, so big board games were still your kind of passion.
Yeah, they still are.
Yeah.
I like that social interactivity. Yeah, to be able to look people in the eye and stab them in the back.
Yeah.
It's a great feeling.
So Dominic and Mark came to you with a proposition, if I'm telling the story correctly, which was to create.
Yeah, they'd seen Death Trap Dungeon was top of the charts, and they decided that they wanted they'd like somebody like me to create their first game for them. But I was not, and still am not, a programmer or an artist, but I could help with the design of it. So they found a team in Hungary to create it.
So this was on the back of the Kit Williams Masquerade book.
That was their idea, being the marketing guys. They were offering a £25,000 prize for the first person to solve the mystery. Some of the clues were in the program itself, of course, in the game. Some of the clues were in the illustrations in the rule book. And if you got it all right, you'd end up with a phone number, which you dialed. Look at these stunning graphics, almost as good as Alan Weasel. You ended up with a phone number, which was inside a solicitor's office, an answer phone. And first person to dial that number won 25 grand. And I remember on national TV handing over a check.
25 grand. I was hoping.
So the winner, it wasn't you.
Is this broken, Phil? My machine's... Oh, here he is.
Hi, Ian. It's Robert Bond. Sorry I can't be with you in person, but congratulations on being interviewed this evening at what I imagine will be a very successful event. I well remember that you and I worked back in 1985 on Eureka, a fantastic game from Domark, where you designed it and the winner of the game, who cracked a code, which was a phone number to an answer phone at my home, was going to get £50,000. I used to come home each day waiting for the red light to flash on the answer phone. One day, after about 8 months, it did. Only to find it was a heavy breather who'd got the wrong number by chance and was muttering and swearing down the phone. And then a few months, well, no, weeks later, a little chap called Matthew Woodley said, I claim the prize. And he turned out to be only a young teenager. You somehow took him under your wing and got him coming into Domark to give you ideas on what kids really wanted in games. And then subsequently was so good, of course, you offered him a job. He became a director of Domark. Domark became IDOS, and the rest is history. Your mentoring, your commitment to the industry, and your leadership means it's an honour and a privilege to be talking with you today. and long may you continue to serve the industry. Thanks, Ian. Bye.
Very nice. Thank you.
Mr. Livingstone,
thank you very much. Sorry he's not here for me to say thank you to him.
Yeah. So Eureka was a pretty big success for Denmark, right?
Yeah, it certainly put them on the map. Mm. I mean, again, it was still quite early days for computer games at that time, but it certainly made people pay attention to Denmark. And as they were marketing men, they were also able to do pretty good deals, and they ended up, their vision was to get lots of licenses.
Because they did the Bond games, right?
Yeah, Denmark did Bond games, they did Formula One, they got Prince of Persia, they got Triple Pursuit license. They had an amazing stable of license, which was odd for me because I had always been interested in creating my own intellectual property. Mm. You know, from the early days of D&D, realizing if it doesn't belong to you, you're nothing more than a parcel forwarder. Mm. And if you want to create real value and determine your own destiny, which I've always wanted to do, you've got to create and retain ownership of your own intellectual property. Mm. So from Warhammer to Fighting Fantasy, and what I did at Eidos was to always try and get new and original content. So I think if you look at the catalogue of Eidos games, it's been essentially own IP. Mm. You know, Tomb Raider, Hitman, Just Cause, Deus Ex, Thief, etc., Championship Manager, all were owned by the company.
Mm. Will you tell us a little bit about 1991 and when you left?
No, I've got to leave now.
left Games Workshop. What that felt like. This is your first.
Yeah, 91 was the selling Games Workshop to a management buyout. It was, you know, we'd been at Workshop for a long, long time, and probably with hindsight, we shouldn't have sold out completely. It should have been nice to retain some ownership of what was once our baby. But, no regrets other than, it's a bit like a child leaving home. You know, they've gone, they're doing their own thing now. You start them off on life. And it's good to see, in fact, that Workshop is not really doing that much different from all those years back. They've just scaled it to a much bigger operation because they're publicly funded now. And it's still basically the same thing. It's still Warhammer, still Own Shop, still White Dwarf, still giving painting demos and creating this uniquely hobby atmosphere. That's differentiated it from all the other games companies. Yeah. And it's great to see that, you know, in a way our legacy lives on.
Yeah.
We don't have any more financial interest in Workshop, but you know, I'm delighted to see it succeed.
So I wrote an answer to what you said about that when we spoke. This is years ago that you said this. Were you just talking about as an entrepreneur you enjoy having a vision of where you'd like to go with the idea? But so you tend to do the pioneering stuff and then get someone else in to run it because they're going to do a lot better than I am. And I think you find that with a lot of creative people. They can only get to a certain point, and unless they bring in genuine, hard-nosed business people to run it, they're going to struggle because at the end, they end up not doing the things that they're good at, which are ideas.
Yeah.
So is that, we talked about this earlier, it must kind of feed into some of the Livingstone Hope kind of thoughts you've been doing. Is that a peculiarly British thing, do you think? Is that kind of separation that we quite often do of creatives and the hard-nosed business people?
Well, I think that this country is uniquely creative. I think we argue we're the most creative nation in the world, not just in games, but in fashion, film, music, TV, advertising, architecture, comedy, whatever. We are very good at it. But we're not always so great at business. And I believe that you should do what you're good at and don't do what you're not good at. And if you're a creative person creating content, you've got no business really ordering toilet rolls or doing the VAT or trying to raise finance or trying to understand a balance sheet and a P&L and do cash flow projections and trying to understand the mentality of the VC or the investment community. You know, you should have an understanding, but you shouldn't be doing it yourself. You need to partner with business people to grow your business. Don't get so protective that you don't want to give up any equity in your business, because you need that person to drive and scale your business. Well, how else are we going to build a Google, a Twitter, a Facebook, or a Zynga in this country. Mm. We have often limited ambition, or just think, you know, I don't want to, or I don't want to do this, or I want to sell out, or it's a slightly different approach to business in the UK, and therefore we have to make sure there's more business skills to enable creatives to be the people they deserve to be.
Right.
Rather than trying to do it yourself, I firmly believe that you partner. You don't lose any control. You don't lose the kudos of, because it's still your business, unless you give up more than 50% of equity. But don't be afraid of giving up some. So I'd rather have, you know, 50% of that than 100% of this.
Yeah, for sure. Can we bring, are we ready to? We thought it's kind of a useful moment to talk about that, because we have another guest that we'd like to invite to join us this evening. We often do these things from the desk of when we're at these events where people Skype in to have a bit of a chat with us. And
is this one going to work?
It might not. I mean, this is more complicated than just sharing a small piece of video, so it might not. But we're giving. Are we ready for our guest to join us, Lee? Yeah, we're almost ready for that, because somebody who probably has also got views about the topic that you're talking about. So it's just is our guest there? I tell you what, this is it's tough, isn't it? Normally it's the audience that are quite difficult. It's tonight. It's very different.
How different? Well, they're normal.
They're much louder normally. There's a lot of shouting. No, there really is. There's a lot of.
You can heckle, I don't mind.
Yeah, has anybody got any questions for Ian at this point, whilst we just.
Oh my god. Oh,
look!
Oh no.
Oh, look. Do you want to just lean forwards and say hello? The camera's just here if you want to just.
It's the man with the can.
Good evening. Mr. Molyneux, would you mind saying hello so can we hear you? Mr. Molyneux?
Hello, I can hear you. Can you hear me?
Yes, excellent. Can everyone just say hello to Peter?
Hello!
Hello, everyone. Not sure the web video is working terribly well, but the audio is working fine. On my screen, I'm frozen in this sort of Simon Cowell's staring down at Ian Livingstone, which I've always thought, you know, that's the way it should be.
Well, we can see you okay, Peter.
Oh, really? Right, okay. Yeah. This is my home, everyone.
It's very nice. Which room of your home are we in?
I'm in the office.
It's very kind of you to invite us into it this evening, Peter. Everyone here is very excited. Excited, obviously, because you know we're here talking about Ian's life and work. Excited because we learned today that you're coming to the festival, which we're all very excited about.
Yep, super excited.
I tried to put them off from having you, Peter, by the way.
Yeah. I know. I can imagine that everything was going swimmingly until you put your tuppence in, Ian, but there you go.
Peter, we've just been talking about Ian's career and Ian's contribution to games, but maybe before we get to a kind of overview of it, I guess one of the things we've just been talking about is the relationship between creatives and business people, and the relationship between, you know, creative ideas and the becoming units of IP that, you know, that people can generate brands and money from, and, you know, and wealth and jobs. And we were just talking about some of the kind of difficulties perhaps in British business culture of that being something that becomes a natural wedding, if you like, of creative people and business people. You've had some experience of that over your career, I know. I wonder if you've got any reflections on that from, you know, based on your own career.
Yeah, I mean, I think it's an interesting thing. Is that you know, there's no doubt in my mind that the British are just wonderfully creative. You know, they're fantastically creative. They come up with some crazy ideas. There was a statistic around for a long time, which was, you know, a third of all games at one point in time had British influence. I don't know who came up with that. Probably Ian. but we are. Desperately awful of having the confidence to exploit those ideas. And, you know, it just frustrates the hell out of me that, you know, people, talented people leave for other countries, and that, you know, especially Americans, you know, come in and buy various companies, two of mine. I'm not complaining that much, by the way, but, you know, it is sad that there wasn't much in the way of British talent. And that's one thing that Ian did do, is he was at the helm of a hugely successful franchise of Tomb Raider, and I think his ability to match that creativity with that with the business acumen is really astounding. That being said, he does cheat at board games and stabs me in the back all the time. I have to get in a little dig there here and there.
Peter, can we just talk through the current Games Night league table? Who's winning and who's last? Who's bottom at the moment?
Who's at the bottom?
I think last time I looked, it was you.
That, exactly. That's exactly right. Who rides the league table?
Me.
There we go. Need I say any more?
Well, that's very kind of you to say that, but I understand business, but I'm not a hard-nosed businessman. I'm more interested and involved with content creation and content direction, but I'm not the guy who's going to go and cut the best deal or do the distribution or scale a business like Americans are able to scale businesses to the size of Google, Twitter, Facebook, Zynga, etc. That takes a certain mentality, a driven mentality, to become global on a massive scale. And I think we have different ambitions in the UK.
But you've both, I think it's fair to say, certainly, most recently you, Peter, have come to a point where you have been involved in big global companies and taken a step back. I mean, but you, I don't know if it's fair to characterize a fighting fantasy books as that, but if that feels like a very personal you alone in a room making what you wanted to make endeavor after being involved in a big company like GE. I'm just not necessarily analogous with Peter's departure from Microsoft.
Well, everyone likes to feel like they can make a difference, and when you're writing a book, clearly you're making a big difference. You're doing it all. And when you're working in these small, agile teams and able to reach global audiences today, this second golden age of games that everyone's migrating to in a hurry because they get that satisfaction in a relatively short term and get customer feedback as well. If one person writes one good thing about something I've created, that makes me happy. Mm. If I'm part of a small team doing a small job over a period of 3 years with 200 people in that team, which may or might not get success, may or may not be successful, that for me is less rewarding. Mm. But having said that, I'm absolutely thoroughly proud of what we achieved with Tomb Raider, but it is a big, big team effort. Not just the developers, the publishers, and everybody's connected to it. And you know, there's a different criteria. I like this personally, being on the creative side in a much smaller team.
Mm. Mm. It's the same with me, really. I mean, it's just, for me, it's the path of least resistance. I mean, if you've got, you know, I'm lucky enough and hugely lucky to be in a position where people would listen to an idea that I may have. And, it you know, where is the best place to curate and nurture that idea into a successful product? And for me, it's in a small a development team of, you know, 20 or so incredibly bright people all working passionately on one thing. That's what I find, you know, is the best way of nurturing something.
Peter, one of the things we've been wanting to work out tonight is interesting your reflections on this, really, is what Ian does and what his, if it was possible to kind of distill his his kind of talent into a few specific things. Is there anything you could add to that?
Remember, before you say that, I actually write the newsletter, Peter.
Yes, I'm fully aware of that. I also remember you can't get any worse than being in bottom place. So, no, I'll be honest here. I mean, Ian has always had this amazing talent, in my mind, to bridge a gap between, you know, crazy creative people like myself and absolute, you know, business and government and you know, people that run scared from people like myself. And he understands that creative process, often adds to that creative process. And he's a great, just a fantastic intermediary in there. And I've seen him spot in some intuitive, almost superpower-like way, you know, brilliant ideas and, you know, just make those ideas better. And that is an incredibly rare talent. And also it's an incredibly rare talent to be able to cheat without ever being spotted at a ball.
Maybe they're connected.
I'm sure they are.
It's a case of...
I would mention one word to Ian, and that is the word Africa. We played a board game once, and he managed to stab everyone simultaneously at the same time and still come out the good guy. Don't quite still to this day know how he did that.
But that wasn't cheating. That was just pure skill to get five.
Well, yes, I suppose so. I still it still confuses me enough to slightly believe it can't be just skill.
Peter, you're welcome to stay with us. We're just I don't know if you know. Ian was going to be staying in. Are we allowed to say why you have to leave? It's quite. Sorry, it's a question to Ian. Peter, is it we allowed to say why you have to leave? It's quite exciting. Peter was going to be staying in. Ian was going to be staying in Nottingham this evening, but sadly has to get in a cab at 9. So we should probably move this along because he has to get to London because
I got a breakfast appointment
with
the Prime Minister.
Yes. The Prime Minister of
this country.
All right. But,
no, it's a creative industries round table breakfast meeting.
You're not invited, Peter.
Are you going, Peter?
No.
If you've done better at Games Night, if you weren't bottom of Games Night, you know.
Yeah,
do you know what? I think in view of the time and the fact we have some questions volunteered already, perhaps, Pete, you're more than welcome to stay if you'd like to. Would you like to stay and interject with any going to help in answering?
Yeah, tell us a little bit about 22 Cans, Peter.
Well, there's the, other than it being a wonderfully, incredibly exciting place that we're building an amazing team at the moment.
You can open your eyes as well.
There's not much else. I can, you know, publicly say at the moment. You know, one of the things I didn't want to do this time is to talk about stuff that wasn't real because I got into lots of trouble. So I, you know, I've said to myself, I'm not going to say anything until we've got some real stuff. That being said, we'll probably have some real stuff tomorrow morning at 9 o'clock while Ian's at the Prime Minister's breakfast.
Does anyone have any questions for Ian or our guest at this point? Or is it a question? Can you just wait until the microphone gets to you, sir?
This one's to Ian. You mentioned how in your youth you were very passionate and involved with your creations. How are you so now? Are you that much involved? Are you playing the Tomb Raider games and stuff?
Well, you have to play the Tomb Raider games to be able to make any worthwhile comment about it. And I was very much involved in the concept of this reboot, this prequel, as it were, because... You know, people complain of sequelitis, so we thought we'd go for a prequel to show how Lara became a Tomb Raider, and that you'll find in this game she's not Teflon coated anymore, that she can suffer injuries and she's a lot more fragile, and therefore we're hoping there's a lot more emotional engagement with her as a character. So yes, I do play games, and yes, I do get involved in the content I create. You know, I've spent the last 2 years writing a new Fighting Fantasy game book, not because it's going to sell millions of copies, because it isn't, because that market has virtually disappeared, but it's for the passion and want to do something right. So I hate mediocrity. I always try and put my best into everything. And I think, you know, in a very competitive world in which we live, you're almost obliged to do that in everything you do. So, you know, I do try my best. I certainly try my best to win all the board games with Peter and Steve and everybody. And I think talking about what my skill is, I try to engage people on an emotional level as well as a sort of intellectual level. I mean, so many people just pump out their raw IQ, but forget about the impact they're having on people around them. And if you want, if you have a vision, you've got to engage emotionally with people and get them to buy into your dream so you can make it happen. And I think that's one of the reasons, we managed to have so much success with the Next Gen campaign is to get everybody on your side, not by telling them, but by inviting them to share, you know, your own dreams and your own vision. So anyway, enough of that, I'm rabbiting.
I was transfixed. Any more questions for it?
So technically, I have one more to Ian. Have you played Canal Mania?
Canal Mania?
Oh.
This is clearly something...
Good question.
Is that root canal?
Well, it's something to do with the amazing waterways of the country.
No, but I fear you'll be telling me how I shall in the very near future. Is this a game that you created?
Ian, the other Ian will be able to inform you about this. It was brought to our attention at the last GameCity Nights.
Are you offering me a free narrowboat holiday?
In hexagonal square form.
My colleagues, David Haywood runs a board game night in Nottingham called Gambling Lambs, which happens every month.
Tomorrow.
It happens tomorrow, but you're going to be with the Prime Minister. GameCity Nights last week, David brought along a copy of this game that he really wanted to like, but just couldn't, because it's about, it reduces, you know, the kind of, both the kind of artwork of the British countryside and the, you know, the kind of grandeur of canal building to a, it's fair to say, brown hexagon. But he bought the board game.
The board game.
I've
got over 1,000 board games at home.
But not Canal Mania.
But not Canal Mania.
Do you want to buy it? Because he's got it.
I'm not sure if it sounds like it merits a place on the shelf.
How much do you want for it? Tenner?
Tenner. Is it good? Well, is it six player? Because our group's six players. Sometimes we have someone away sick or on holiday, so we can cope with five.
It's a good game. The designers just made some bad commercial choices for that, which is why I think it's interesting.
Okay. Sounds like I need to have one.
All right, well...
I'll buy one.
We can fix you. There's another question just over here at the back, I think.
Sir, what do you think of the old-school revolution with the whole idea of Dungeons & Dragons really coming back? Obviously, you've got your Final Fantasy. I'm really looking forward to Blood of the Zombies, by the way. And the idea that basically you brought Dungeons & Dragons to this country. And back then, obviously, as you stated, you couldn't really get any information off people. Your bank manager looked at you as if an Alsatian watching your television. But nowadays, we've got things like Skyrim, and to give it the games idea, and also Game of Thrones, that whole feel of, like, your idea, your feeling of, like, you could go to these fantasy worlds that's really being brought into play now. How does it feel to be someone who's created those, say, four things and brought them forward, those four domains of Tomb Raider, Games Workshop and that, who's helped bring forth those ideas?
Answer. I've got to go now. Best of luck, Ian.
Oh, and he's still there. We thought you'd gone ages ago.
Really?
No, oh, there's Lucas. Hello, Lucas.
Hello, Lucas.
Hi.
Hello. Say hello to Lucas, hello, everyone. Lucas.
Good night, everyone, and best of luck tomorrow morning, Ian.
Good night. Thank you, Peter.
See you soon.
See you, Lucas.
I wonder where that voice is coming from.
Basically, to sum up, what's it feel
like... Oh, sorry, yeah, I forgot. There's a question, isn't it?
Yeah, sorry about that. Yeah. What's it feel like to be going from that bedroom with making the wooden games and that to going to now, looking back, and seeing all these opportunities and the whole sort of games going from go to 10 and go to 20 to being areas where you can simply lose yourself in these magical worlds that you imagined as a child? That probably makes it better.
Well, I've thoroughly enjoyed my career, clearly. I've had a great time. Being able to convert my hobby into a business is a privilege and a luxury. The stuff that I've been associated with, the fact that it's been successful and had an impact on the gaming world, makes me feel very proud. I always feel a little bit embarrassed talking about stuff like this, but I am fundamentally exceedingly proud about it. And, you know, it gives me a great sense of achievement, and the fact that people enjoyed what I enjoy is great. But a lot of credit has to go to Dungeons & Dragons and to Gary Gygax and Dave Arneson. Sadly, neither are, and both are no longer with us. And you know, without Dungeons & Dragons, would we have had World of Warcraft? I doubt it. You know, would we have had Fighting Fantasy even? Perhaps not. So the debt really goes further than Steve and I. But you know, we're pleased to what we've done, particularly for the UK, and to help build an industry that has always been seen so negatively in the press. I've been delighted to fight the cause, because mm-hmm. you know, I'm very proud of the games industry, that the positives, rather than people who focused on the negatives or the, you know, the things, whether games-based learning or games used as a training tool or games just simply as entertainment, and the positives within that, the social engagement, the interaction, the fact that it's a lot more fulfilling and rewarding experience than just watching traditional linear entertainment, that you're solving puzzles and problems and intuitive learning and choice and consequence and improving social skills and understanding technology, la-di-da-di-la. There's so many good things about games. That these sort of stupid headlines that still exist in some of the sensationalist press, you know, that's going to disappear. And I'm glad to have helped drive those stupid opinions away. And this is a great industry. It's a very successful industry for the UK. You guys are the future. You know, you're the talent of the future. You know, we've done our bit, but you know, we want that heritage to continue and to make the UK the absolute best country in the world for creating content and maintaining ownership of that content. And you know, games have been my life, and I've enjoyed every minute of it.
Thank you. Thank you for helping bring that to Nottingham. And yeah, thank you for everything.
Do you know what? Are there any more? There's another question at the bar. Go on, Phil.
There's one over there too.
Oh, is there? I'm sorry.
Hi. I think it might be fair to say then, from your own descriptions this evening, that you've gone pretty much from sort of rank outsider to influencer of cabinet policy with your sort of fancy breakfast tomorrow morning. Good luck with that. I just wanted to ask, with the recent sort of Raspberry Pi initiative with Eben Upton and his team trying to get computer science back into the classroom and trying to get back to basics, if you like, with programming as a core concept, what are your feelings around that issue and around trying to sort of engage the youth of today with programming as more of a kind of relevant concept?
Well, I hope you might know we co-authored the Next Gen Skills Review at the behest of Ed Vaese, the Culture Minister, in February last year. We launched our report, and our main recommendation was to have computer science onto the school's national curriculum as an essential discipline, because we'd found, as a company, and I also chair the Computer Games Skills Council for Skillset as a sector skills council, that there simply weren't enough good graduates coming out of universities with hard skills who could actually make games. What we require, of course, is computer programmers, artists, and animators. And so many graduates were coming out of universities with soft skills. They were learning about the philosophy of games, the social relevance of Grand Theft Auto in society, but they hadn't got a clue how to make them. And that was because so many university courses, 144 courses in the UK with the word type games in them, were simply media study courses with the word media crossed out and games inserted. And they were purporting wrongly to be offering a true games course. Now, of course, we need games designers. You know, without, for me, design is the most important thing, and technology and graphics supports the experience that the designer envisages. But you don't need that many in a team. We need these programmers, artists, and animators. So our Next Gen report wanted to know why there weren't enough children coming out of school wanting to study computer science at university. And we found the root cause really was ICT, as it was taught in schools. It was simply nothing more than office skills and secretarial skills. We were boring kids to death with Word, PowerPoints, and Excel. And whilst useful office skills, they're never going to give you a career in the creative digital industries, especially not the games industry. And hence our main recommendation. And the Next Gen report was talked about in the games press and in small pockets of national press, but it didn't get that sort of whirlwind of support until Eric Schmidt, the chairman of Google, referenced our report last year in his Matt Taggart lecture. He said it was a travesty that we'd thrown away, the UK had thrown away its computing heritage, the works of Turing and Tim Berners-Lee, and the fact that we used to have computer science all those years ago just simply disappeared. We've abandoned the polymath approach of combining the arts and the sciences, and he just couldn't understand it. And he said this in his MacTaggart lecture, and of course, you know, if Eric says it, it must be true. And a month later, the Prime Minister announced at Tech City that, you know, we should have more computer science in school. And then, of course, that opened the door to us being invited in to meet the special advisor at number 10 and also the Department for Education. And we were able to explain our proposition that ICT was simply teaching children how to use an application, but gave no insight how to make an application. We were effectively teaching children how to read, but not to write. And it was like, I see, a problem. Yes, indeed a problem. Especially since in the 1980s, the BBC Micro was a cornerstone of computing in schools, and in the homes, the Sinclair Spectrum was an affordable, programmable computer. And that all kind of got lost over time as computers got locked down. I think it was David Blunkett who put the stoppers to people being able to program computers. And over time, people just assumed that ICT was computing, when it absolutely had nothing at all to do with it. So the special advisor at DfE took on board the recommendations and said this is exactly the solution they've been looking for, because we're not alone. And subsequent to that, we then formed a cross-industry coalition. And we got Microsoft, Google, Facebook, Intellect, Sector Skills Councils, the British Computer Society, have all signed up to our Next Gen Skills, which was funded, I might say, by UKI, one of the two trade associations. And we continue to lobby, with the result that this January, Michael Gove, Secretary of State for Education, said in his BET speech that he's going to withdraw the current program for ICT and replace it with a curriculum with computer science at its core. So this is a transformational moment as far as the UK is concerned, I would say. And come the September, there's going to be a new curriculum. But they put it back to industry and our coalition partners to come up with a course that is rigorous and robust to satisfy DfE, and yet exciting, relevant, and, you know, wonderfully exciting for children to want to do it in the first place. So we're hoping that key stage one, they can use Kodu, and 10-year-olds can download Scratch and creating little 2D animations, and by age 16 they'll be writing their own programs. And of course, getting back to your original point, the Raspberry Pi is a wonderfully timed initiative to help drive this through, because for £22, there you have a Linux operating system, a programmable computer. It'll have educational software embedded in it by this autumn, and 256 meg of RAM and iPhone quality video playback. This is brilliant. And if the kids lose it, who cares? Give them another one. So this is a huge opportunity for the UK to reestablish itself as a leader in creating technology. And we are a creative nation, but if we don't empower our creators with the skills to realize that creativity, because we are living in a digital world now, we are dependent on the digital economy, and code touches everything we do. And they say it's not just games, it's financial services, designing cars, designing architecture. We cannot build a digital economy with a nation of digital illiterates, full stop. We used to manufacture things using our brawn, we now use our brain. We're moving from analog to creating manufacturing using code. Wake up.
That's good. And obviously the Pi, the Raspberry Pi at sort of 20 odd pounds, literally a tenth of the price of the BBC B, which was kind of the inspiration almost part of it. Have you had a chance, or do you anticipate having a chance, or have you got one on order, or are you looking to get one? Mine has just shipped today, so hopefully we'll be here by next week.
I'm neither an educationalist nor a programmer. I can't write a line of code. And if that little blank screen came up, if I plugged in a Raspberry Pi into a monitor, I wouldn't know what to do. I have not benefited from being taught how to code. I hope you guys have, and you'll be able to benefit from the Raspberry Pi, because you know, a device like this is going to help transform this nation, I believe.
Fingers
but
crossed.
I am getting one, of course.
Right. There's a question just at the front, Penny.
Hi, Ian. I just wanted to ask, having known that found out you're playing the game tonight, what your favourite game was from?
I don't have a particular favourite of anything, whether it's a country or a restaurant or meal or film. I think you have something that's relevant to how you're feeling at a time. So it's hard to say whether in a computer game, is it you want to play on a console, do you want to play on an iPhone, it's single player, multiplayer, whatever. And same with board games. At Games Night, we play what we call a game of substance. Stupid old title, which is usually a big game, and then we'll end the evening with a series of small games for fun. But the type of games I do like playing, and this is just a range of games like Seven Wonders, the old game Acquired by Sid Saxon, Puerto Rico, Kalis, kind of strategy games with lots of negotiation, building stuff.
Cool, thank you.
Just take one more question from Adam.
Hi. On what you were saying earlier about the difficulty creatives in the UK have growing their businesses or seeking investment, partnering with other business people, it strikes me that there's a great tradition in Britain of a kind of gentlemanly dissent that perhaps is a great spur to all this innovation that we've achieved over hundreds of years. Your own story speaks of that, I think, from what you were saying early on in this, the biographical stuff. You know, a kind of distaste almost for playing the game and conforming. And isn't there a tension there between the British character of dissent and the need for playing certain games to grow as a business? Do you think it will always be the case that at a certain scale, British creative businesses have to partner with foreign businesses like US investors or Far Eastern investors, as happened with Eidos, to grow beyond a certain scale, because our culture perhaps will never have that kind of attitude?
It was weird when you were talking about the education point. They actually took the chairman of an American company to mention the report to make it have any traction. In the UK, there's a horrible irony in that. Sorry to interrupt, but I mean it's kind of backing up Adam's point.
Yeah, you may well be right, but I hope that we can understand that businesses shouldn't be seen as a vulgar trade, that people shouldn't have the skills to build businesses, because you know, there's nothing to be embarrassed about building a business. If you can, particularly in games, you can get the whole world to play your game, fantastic. But we have to partner, I think, here. And we can't expect the creatives to do it themselves. But they should not be afraid of letting go. That's very well for me to say that, because I didn't want to let go either of Games Workshop. But yeah, with the benefit of hindsight, I think it's definitely best to partner, as long as you don't lose control, to let other people drive that scale.
Should we just one more question then from Stephen?
Hi. You talk about, obviously, in the early days, sort of combining with working with games into books and games with board games. These days, we seem to see a lot of films embedded in games, Heavy Rain and some of the other titles like Just Cause and stuff like that. What's your opinion on the way that sort of games and sort of films are coming together? And should there be a line drawn, or should that sort of phase between the two be okay?
Yeah, that's the beauty of the games industry. There's so much different way of presenting the proposition, whether it's an interactive cinematic experience like that you're describing, or a simple puzzle game played on a mobile device. It's up to the individual. There's room for everything, and as the industry grows, with more diverse content, with more socially inclusive for young and old, male and female playing games together or singly, in the living room or connected via the internet. You know, technology drives innovation in games, and there's new opportunities, and that, for me, is what makes it so much more compelling than just traditional linear entertainment, because of the variety and different ways of consuming and enjoying our interactive entertainment that we love so much. So I don't think any line should be drawn. I think people should just make what they feel like making and let the public decide.
Thank you.
That is an excellent note, I think, an excellent optimistic and bold note to probably draw this to a close. I know we've only got to get kind of 20 minutes until you have to dash for that important cab. Thank you so much for your generosity of coming up to spend an entire day with us, a three-show day, of which is the last.
Absolutely, my pleasure.
We hope at some time we can schedule the festival when it doesn't collide with your family holiday.
Half-term.
And we're going to plan for that in the future. But once again, thank you so much for coming up. We hope you've had a wonderful day. We very much enjoyed having you here. Ladies and gentlemen, Ian has 20 minutes, I'm sure, to sign copies of Death Trap Dungeon that you've all brought with you once he's signed mine. Please, can we just show our appreciation for Mr. Ian Livingstone?
Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you.